In this video, we're going to learn how to combine a Google Earth image with a base file to create a unique result in just a few steps. This workflow is easy and can be quickly done, but it opens a lot of possibilities to enhance master plans, site analysis, site plans, you name it. Okay, so this is an updated version of an old video I have here on the channel, where I didn't cover no way near enough. So this video will teach you a lot more things with a lot more useful moves. And it's crazy to think that that video just hit 1 million views. So, as you saw in the intro, there are a few possible options here. I'm gonna show you how to get to this specific result, but once the file is set up, you can quickly change and experiment to achieve many other results. There are literally endless styles that you can try. And then at the very end of this video, I'm gonna give you an extra idea, a really simple way to animate lines over an image like this using After Effects. Now, this video is sponsored by Conceptual, and I use the Conceptual 7 Ezel during the whole process, which is a very versatile device that enables you to work with heavy workflows, but also gives you that creative flexibility with the number of features that it has. But I'll talk more about the specs over the video. And lastly, before we jump into the tutorial, if you're new to the channel, I'm Oliver, and here we talk about architectural visualization and representation. Consider subscribing if you like this type of content. Okay, so now let's take a look at the process. So listen up, you need a base drawing to make things easier here. Well, it's not mandatory to have one. You could totally work directly with the Google Earth image, but with a base like this, the process just gets automated and you get things done in a matter of seconds with this shortcut that I'm gonna show you. If you don't have a base, you will have to do it all by hand and it's a lot of manual work. Now, you can get a base like this with roads, blocks, parks and everything in many places actually. It just really depends on your location and how accessible these files are for you. So, to help you out, let me tell you a couple of possible ways to get a hold of files like these that I know of. The first one, and how I got the base map files when I was in architecture school, the Urbanism City Department of my city provide these .shape files that can be opened in a geographic information system type of software. You export with a set scale in PDF or vector shapes, and then you can work in Illustrator, Photoshop, and so on as usual. I know that a lot of architecture schools already have these files on hand and can give them to students when needed. And I know that sometimes these base files can come in a large and immense CAD file, and then you would have to crop your area out, but that's already a start. Another way is to go onto the website called CAD Mapper. That's actually how I downloaded this specific area here. And it's free up to some area, but it doesn't get too expensive if you need a larger area. Not ideal, I know, but if you don't have contact with a local city department, this can be a viable alternative. There are probably other websites out there like this one. And a third method is to manually trace it based on Google Earth. I know this is not ideal, but I have done this in the past, especially when working with outskirt areas when there's usually no base files available. And it's time consuming at first. Yeah, not gonna lie, but once it's done, it can save you a ton of time. Now, I wanna ask you this, do you have any other places that you go to when you need base files like this, or does your professor, your architecture school always make them available? If you can, share with the community down in the comments below and we can help each other out. Okay, so with the base files on your hand, and now listen, there are 1,000 possible workflows here. I'm gonna show you the one that I use for this particular image, the one that for me got the job done quicker and allows me more creative possibilities once the file structure is set up, okay? And since we're talking about multiple results and the fact that the Conceptual 7 Ezel has a color accurate touchscreen with pen support, I could certainly use this base image as is to sketch over it and quickly produce some initial site analysis or possible master plans. This obviously is more conceptual and not so much a finished piece, but having this creative possibility with a strong device like this as an architect is really interesting. Okay, so with the base on hands, export one PNG image for each level of information. And here, if you export it up to scale, it should be all sized up correctly and you're good to go. You don't need to give any thoughts on colors just yet. What we need is just the overall shapes. And now you might be guessing where this is going, right? We're gonna use each image, each layer as masks or sort of clipping masks to be more precise. So PNG is what you're gonna need, okay? Perfect, now that you have the base file ready, let's go to Google Earth. Then Google Earth, which has been discontinued as a standalone software and now is only accessible as a browser. Well, you can still download it and install the last version available. We're gonna use it to export a high quality 4K resolution image. And a couple of quick tips here. Under Tools, Options, and navigation, check the Do Not Automatically Tilt While Zooming. This ensures that you get a top-down view image and it's not all distorted. Then go to your desired location and just to double check, mouse will click and drag it up to make it flat. In my case here, I want the north pointing up so you can click it. Cool, now uncheck all of the information labels here and finally go to File, Save, Save Image. Uncheck all and choose the highest resolution possible. Now save it. Okay, so with these files, we can go to Photoshop to assemble all of this together. Here in Photoshop, I find it easier to copy the same file dimensions from the base image, which in my case here is Illustrator, but it could certainly be the AutoCAD, ArchiCAD or Revit sheet that you have. This is not that important, as you can always crop it down the road in Photoshop if needed. Just try not to resize the base files here in Photoshop, okay? Or you will lose the scale that you have set up. Okay, so then import all of the individual layers of information here. And here comes the trickiest step of this video. Match the Google Earth photo to the base file. This is a trial and error type of situation. There are no rules here, but usually getting the north arrow pointing in the same direction should make things easier. For some reason, mine here was just lining up by rotating a bit, which caused some border mismatches. But again, you can always crop it later or expand the area back in Google Earth if needed. And now here comes the move that makes this process so useful. We can create a copy of this aligned and properly sized up Google Earth image, drag it above the buildings. And if we use the shortcut Ctrl+Alt+G, it will only show where the buildings are. Therefore, it's basically using the buildings as a mask to reveal the Google Earth image only where needed. Pretty cool, right? And then obviously you can treat this as any other layer. For example, I feel that some hue and saturation adjustment layer here to remove some of the reds could look good so that we still maintain a bit of the color differences and detail, but it doesn't stand out too much. Just remember to have it clipped too so that it only affects the buildings. And then by lowering the opacity of this building main layer here, the whole thing can be adjusted at once. This workflow still has just a few layers and this image is not that large since I'm only doing it for digital purposes, but imagine if you were going to print this on an A0 for example, you would need a lot more quality and things can get heavy pretty quickly, especially with all the base files in this urban scale. So having a SSD, especially an NVMe PCIe, which is what the Concept-D7 Ezel has, will allow you to work faster and more efficiently. If you're looking to upgrade your setup, be aware that not all types of SSD are that fast. It's not only about the size of it, like how many gigs it has, but also its type. So don't forget to take that into account. Now, so back to the process, the next move will depend a lot on the area you're working on, whether you have bodies of water, parks, or other highlighted areas, but textures are a great way to create contrast here. For example, just by adding a generic watercolor texture on top of the water layer, clipping it, of course, then changing the mode to multiply. And I'm making this black and white so that we can add the color separately with an individual fill. This just allows us to experiment with different colors and have more flexibility. See, we start to get some interesting looks here. You can even add some slight depth by going to the blending options and adding an inner shadow. My suggestion is always this. Slide all the sliders to see how they affect your image, and then you can fine tune it to however you like it, but I'm going for something soft here. Next up, I'm gonna work with the green areas. And look, we already have a lot going on the buildings and the water. Here, just changing the color and adding some noise should be enough. And to maintain the non-destructive workflow, we can do this in an individual layer. For example, we can add a clipped layer with 50% gray. Then we add the noise to this layer. And change the blend mode to overlay. so that we give this whole set of layers a overlay of noise without having to add directly to the park layer. Because if we do it like this, later on, as you saw in the intro, we can quickly change the colors and make subtle changes to the other layers to get very different results in terms of color combinations. So it's important to have a non-destructive layer structure here. Now I'm gonna go ahead and even categorize this file so that I can visualize it better on the layer stack. And adding trees to the park areas can be challenging here. Again, we already have a lot going on. I wouldn't want to add realistic or very detailed trees, or else it can get messy and cluttered. So with the simple round brush, but changing the brush settings to randomize it, we can get an interesting result in a matter of seconds. And now that I'm adding the trees, I can see that the water is covering some bridges. And since I'm using a non-destructive workflow, I can easily add a mask to the water layer and hide where necessary. And the Google Earth image is great to help me see where the information is. Okay, with the base pretty much stylized and properly set up, we can now start thinking about the extra info, how to highlight information over this interesting base. This step will highly depend on your site and your project, but let's say that you want to highlight a road, for example, an axis over a master plan you're proposing. So in a new layer, paint over the street with an accent color. And this can be done with a simple brush, a selection, or pretty much however you feel most comfortable with. And then you play with the blend modes to make it blend with the rest. I mean, you don't want a solid color hiding the detailed information that Google Earth is giving us, right? But then if it's too light, you can use the same selection, just control click on the thumbnail and add some adjustments like a brightness and contrast below it to make it darker, therefore making the colored area pop a bit more. This same idea can be applied to highlight buildings or blocks. Since we combined the building layer mask with Google Earth, we can easily paint over them to precisely highlight the buildings. Let's add a colored fill above it, and I'm gonna use the same hex code from the street, change the blend mode to color, and invert the mask by hitting Ctrl I. You can already see where this is going, right? Now it's as simple as using a white brush to reveal where we want the buildings or blocks to be highlighted with that color. Let's say certain blocks along the main axis are important, or you could even use different colors to indicate different uses. I mean, with the base divided and well organized like this, it's quite easy to achieve any result. For example, you can even use this to indicate how far certain public equipment would affect an area. If this was the case, I would even export circles with the same scale as this master plan, and then resize the brush to match the area. I mean, the possibilities here are really endless once you have the base set up. Okay, so as I said at the beginning of the video, here's a last idea for you. If you're gonna present an image like this digitally, you can spice your presentation up. After Effects is a fantastic software to create animations. It's part of the Adobe Creative Cloud. So if you have the skills in Photoshop and Illustrator, you'll probably find your way around here as well. But still, this is a very complex program and I won't be able to teach you everything about it here. This last bit of the tutorial is just to spark some interest in you. And if you'd like me to make some After Effects tutorials but focused on architecture, do let me know in the comments below. Okay, so here on After Effects, I'm gonna create a new composition. If you want, you can pause and copy my settings here. Then I'm importing the edit base we have in Photoshop but without any highlights. I just turned it off back in Photoshop to make the actual highlighted line here in After Effects. Then scale and reposition as needed. Then let's get the pen tool. And right off the bat, you can set it up to have no fills and the stroke with the same color you used back in Photoshop. Line thickness is also adjusted here. And as I said, this is an Adobe program, so tools behave very similarly, which is the case of the pen tool. Just make sure that you don't have anything selected to create the line, or you will create a mask on the selected layer, okay? And then to finish this composition, just let me change the blend mode to color, and make sure to toggle switch if you cannot see it. Cool, it was all pretty easy until now, right? But this last move, which is the animation itself, can get a bit trickier. Expand the line and add a trim paths. This is an effect that allows us to animate start and end of a line. It's perfect for what we need. Expand the trim paths, go to the beginning of the timeline, then click on the stopwatch to create a keyframe, drag the percentage to 0, then move the playhead forward and drag the percentage back to 100. Now if we hit play, it's already looking quite interesting. And from now on, it's more about refining the animation itself, making it smoother by easing it. Well, I could talk a lot more about this process if I really wanted to get in depth. I mean, you can tweak the graph, add other layers, play with the opacity as well. But at the end, after a really short process, like a 10-minute process, you can get something like this. And now all there's left to do is just export it. And as you know, a powerful device with a strong CPU can help you in all of your architectural tasks with 3D modeling and all, but it also allows you to explore other creative fields without any hassle. The Concept D7 Ezel has an 11th gen Intel Core processor, which has been an absolute beast to work with any video editing and rendering workflow. I'll leave a link down in the video description if you want to learn more about this versatile and powerful device. Now, with this animation, we end this video. If you made it until here, I feel that you like this type of content, right? So don't forget to subscribe to not miss out on any new videos. And as always, any questions you might have, drop them in the comments below. Thanks a lot for watching, and I'll see you in the next video.